Can you hear me back there? Okay. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for the invitation. I appreciate it. My name is Vincent Chiaramonte. I'm a 1990 graduate of the Academy. I studied illustration and fine art while I was here. I've been working professionally ever since. I've been mainly, in the last 18 years or so, working professionally as a portrait artist on my own. So, with that, I'm just going to go ahead and start showing you some of my work. But at any point, if anybody has a question, please speak up. This is the best way for me to do these kinds of things, because I need to know what you're thinking in order for me to answer what your questions are. So don't hesitate. You're not being rude, so just speak up, okay? All right, I work in three mediums. I work in charcoal, I work in pastel, and I work in oil. So I have these divided into three categories. And I believe I start with pastel here. Yep. So. And I'm just going to kind of rattle through a few of these. I use Rembrandt pastels primarily. I do on occasion use Sennelier pastel to pop some of those deep colors, but like I say, primarily Rembrandt pastel on the pastel paper, Mietens, however you say that, Mietientes, stuff that you use, or the cans. Okay. Many of these people are people I come across in my daily walk. I try to capture people at their essence. At some point, it's not a likeness. That's not the main purpose of my painting anymore. Thankfully, that's not an issue for me. And likeness comes from quality drawing, precise drawing, which can only happen by doing it, by the way. So once that's in the can, now it's about creating the essence of someone. And that's what I try to do with my work. Eyes are the windows to the soul. Some of these are illustrations that have been used in publications. Some are commissions. This is really washed out. Rarely do I spray my work, my pastels. On occasion I will. It's kind of hard to tell in here. In the background I wanted more texture. And in the afghan that she's crocheting, I wanted more texture. So I would spray just so I could build up more pastel. This is being used by a paper company out of Germany as part of their ad campaign for their fine art paper commissions. I often see people and I'll walk by and say there's a portrait waiting to happen. And before I would be shy and not want to ask that person. Those days are long gone. I take advantage of those times. Most times people are really receptive. Yes?
How long does it take you to complete them?
This piece here, this is probably 6 hours.
Okay, so do you ask them to come into your studio?
I do. I wish I could work from life all the time. That's the ideal situation. I do shoot my own references. But I can't overemphasize enough drawing from life, because that has to happen before you're able to draw from photos. And you have to also have an eye for light and how to photograph someone. And knowing now, I mean, back in the day, you would take a photo and you would just be at the whim of whoever printed the photo. Now you can go into Photoshop and you can lighten the darks and darken the lights and all that fun stuff. But you have to know in your head what you're looking at and what to edit and what's being edited for you in a photo. And the only way to do that is to work for money. A lot. I love painting hands. This was a commission, actually. For me, hands are like little people. And they can tell an awful lot about, they can tell an awful lot about someone. And oftentimes you'll see someone, it's in a painting, but the hands will be hidden. And I think that it's such a shame. Because yeah, you can avoid painting them, but boy, they can tell an awful lot about someone. I think they're as important in a portrait that's half figure or more as what's happening up here. This is a gentleman I just found out he died. He would come by my studio. My studio's on a, it's in an old warehouse, and it's not in the greatest part of town, but I love the studio. It's northern exposed, big windows. And there are a lot of people, such as this gentleman, who walk by all the time. And they'll stop and they'll look, and I become friends with them. And so, like I say, I don't pass up these opportunities anymore, so I asked him if I could paint him. Came in, it was cold, I gave him a cup of coffee. Found out recently that he had died. Name's Norman.
How do people react when you ask them to paint them when they don't know you?
Like I say, well, I'm in my studio most of the time. So they know of me. They're walking by my studio, it's my space. So they're interested. But in other occasions, if I'm walking by someone, I'll show you later on here. There was, and you may know this gentleman, he may still be here. My studio used to be right next door at the Fine Arts Building. So I'd get off the L and I'd walk to that studio and I'd see this guy selling the Sun Times every day. White beard, African American gentleman. And finally, I just built up the nerve. I said, can I take your photo? And he said, sure. And I stood across the street with a telephoto and just took a bunch of shots, just watched him. I'll show you. They're fine. They're absolutely fine. On occasion, somebody will ask how much you pay me, and I'll say, I'll give you 10 bucks. Sure. It's a pretty inexpensive model. I love people who have done life, faces that have done life. There's so much that's happening behind those eyes. Again, it's not just eyes, nose, mouth, it's not just features. Same here.
Vince?
Yes?
At what point did you know you wanted to specialize in portraits? Was it while you were still here or once you got out?
I'd always done it, even when I was a little guy. I was always into painting people. When I was here, for sure. I was told when I got out, don't do that. You're pigeonholing yourself. Do more stuff. I did a lot of sports art. Rich will remember that. Because I did a lot of, that was my illustration thing. I was into sports. I still am. And kind of combined the sports and the art. And I did okay in it, but I was always doing my portrait work. It's like I was being pulled. So, always, in the short answer. Me. Okay. Here's charcoal. I use vine charcoal. Same kind of stuff you use here. Again, on Canson, pastel paper, toned paper. And drawing for me is key. And just like an athlete, you gotta stay sharp doing this stuff. I draw every day. And not even because I have to, because I love it. I love doing it. Side benefit of that is that it keeps you on your game. Because without it, it doesn't matter, the rest doesn't matter for me. For the kind of work that I do. I do charcoals as part of major commissions as studies. This is a United States Congressman. I was commissioned to paint. You'll see the finished product later. But in communicating with people, especially non-art people, you need to show them what they're going to be getting. And so this was a study that was approved. And then the good thing too is they want to buy them. So I did this charcoal study, I did an oil study. And the other thing too is the more information I can get here, the better that final piece is going to be. When I go to that final canvas, I want all the information I need before I even tone the canvas. I want to know, when I close my eyes at night, I want to know that face inside and out. That's usually the reaction I get. I'm going to show you, I can work, this is using a harder vine charcoal, super tight, takes forever, but it's a nice product and people like it. Parents like this, these two are brothers. It's my niece. Again, a study that went, this is Senator Paul Simon, this was a study. Much looser, using a softer vine charcoal. My John Singer Sargent influence on me. It's the kind of thing you do here. Life drawing. And you have a great teacher. I was just in Don's room there. He's got some incredible stuff. This is working on, you tone the can or paper first. Sandpaper some of the dust on there and then wipe it around and then work negative. Pulling out with the kneaded eraser and then going back in with the vine charcoal. And using editing, pulling out my artistic license. Okay. This is the guy I was talking about. I wouldn't doubt it. But that's what I would see every day, that look. So I worked from photos on this. And the CVS is right at the corner, Adams, Staten Adams. I don't know if he's still there. But this wall is the wall to the Excalibur bar. Does anybody know where that is? Okay, so I had to do a lot of preliminary study work before that. Again, the importance of hands. I love working, I like any kind of light source, but this kind of overcast day, where it's like a big light box out there, real soft, cool light. White
light. Did he see the finished one?
I've since moved from here, so I don't come across him. These are more formal portraits. CEO, like I say, political types. This is that congressman that I was talking about. That study was done for. This has been my biggest get yet. The whole deal, the formal unveiling, the House of Representatives in Washington, me speaking up on the dais with this gentleman and his family in front of every member of Congress.
Wow.
My dream ever since I was a little guy to paint the President of the United States. Even then. And this got me that much closer. President of Northern Illinois University. This is on Masonite, oil on Masonite. See some of those over there. This is a large painting, probably 4 feet by 5 feet. And just like the hands are important, so too are the feet. Easy to pass over and hide, but boy, to do them, it's just...
It's almost like people want to hide feet more than they want to hide hands.
Oh. Yeah, more formal. And these are just quick studies. On linen. Here's some more of the sports stuff that I was talking about. That this is what I started, this is what I was doing when I left the academy. Working for people who would publish such things. Monochromatic oil on masonry. This painting was done black and white and then a wash. This is one of the gentlemen that walks by my studio. That's me in my studio. So, but that's what I have. That whole bay of windows to my left, over my left-hand shoulder, is just that. It's all natural light.
That's really cool.
Natural northern exposed light. The mayor. This is the largest commission I've ever received. It's 7 feet tall. It's life size. It's hanging at Northern Illinois University. This gentleman donated $20 million to the university, and they built a wing or building in his name, Barcima Hall. It's the business school now, and so they commissioned me to paint, he and his wife. Originally, it was just going to be him. And so I did all the studies and the photo shoot and everything. And on the flight back, they live in San Jose. On the way back, he decided he wanted his wife in it. So they had to fly me, along with my photographer, out to San Jose to redo this. This is in their dining room. These are quick little studies. They're fun to do. This is what I mean. You know, if I'm in between something major or if nothing's going on, I need to paint. I'm an artist. And I want to always be getting better. And so I'll find anything, anybody, just to do this because I want to keep sharp and I love what I do. I love doing it. Oh, I threw some non-portrait stuff in here just to save my sanity sometimes. So the little baby with the big cheeks.
And the cat.
Noted.
Is the kitty yours?
It was. She died. Some more sports. Worked on a very textured canvas. Let's see. Oil on masonite again. And to create the texture for this one, I don't know if you can see it, while the gesso was still wet, I just took newspaper. Created bumps. I wanted that old-fashioned baseball card feel. Straightforward. Okay, I have a couple demos here. This is how I started a pastel. Buying charcoal on toned Canson paper. Mi tientes, that's the word I was trying to say earlier. Moonstone, I believe, is what this is. Okay, simple, quick, not too defined, because this is all going to be covered up anyway. But everything's there, all the information. The more you do this, the more you know what you need to put down and what you don't need to put down. Start in. Values are the most important thing first. This is just one piece of pastel. See the shadow pattern starting? Shadow patterns again starting to build up, more pastel. I work middle tone out. Wallowing in the middle tones. That's where all the magic happens. Anybody can pop the highlight or pop the darkest dark. It's in the middle tones. That's where the magic happens. Yes?
Do you blend your pastel work at all?
I let the pastel blend it. That becomes part of touch, and that's knowing how much to layer and how you can overdo that. You can get to the point where you're pushing pastel around. And that just comes with time. It's a slow process. It takes patience, the way I work. A lot of layers. There it is. Same with the hands. Same process. I could actually take it a little bit further, but that's what you get the idea. That's my show. So that's what I do. Who has questions? Yes?
What medium do you enjoy using the most?
All of them. Whenever I get this question, I always put it in these terms. If I'm on a deserted island and I can only take one, it would be pastel. It's the one that I sort of gravitated toward more naturally. And so, yes. It's more direct, so you don't have to worry about drying time.
How do your clients find you, and once you do begin to talk with them,
mm-hmm.
Or how does that process?
How do clients find me is the question. Slowly. It's taken a long time. For me, it's reputation at this point, word of mouth. Everyone here is in such a wonderfully great place in terms of showing your work to the world. That wasn't available when I was in art school. Now you've got all the social medias. You can just post something and the world can see it. For me, it was doing some real legwork. And I took advantage of every opportunity where I thought someone might need a portrait. If someone was retiring, if there was an occasion, an anniversary or something, I would pursue them. I would have flyers, I would have samples of my work, and I would get it out. I follow that little voice inside of me. It said, possibility, possibility, possibility. I always had those antenna up, you know? And lo and behold, it works. It's slow. It takes a lot of effort. But now, with Facebook and everything else, man, it's sweet. You post something, and there it is. So now for me, it is word of mouth. And it's getting those big commissions that beget the next commission.
So when you work with a client, then, like, can you run us through, like, where you start with them?
Sure.
And where it goes?
Mm-hmm. I get a phone call. I'll just use the congressman. This is so-and-so. I am from Congressman Towns' office in Washington, D.C. We'd like to see you. Congressman saw your work. This is how this works. Congressman saw your work at the unveiling of Congressman so-and-so, and he really enjoyed it, and he would like for you to, he's up for commission, and he would like for you to paint his portrait. I'm doing this on the other end of the phone, then trying to be all professional at the same time. And I say, okay. How do we proceed from here is usually the question for me. And I said, well, I would like to come and have a conversation with the congressman, meet with him as much as possible, and to do some studies from life. problem. At the same time, I bring a photographer with me. And we take a ton of photos. So from there, I'm doing life studies, taking photos, back to my studio, doing a lot of thumbnail work, working out in my head the composition of that painting. Not just in my head, but on paper. And then going back and forth with them, along with like that study, the charcoal study, giving them as much information. So there's no guesswork. They're not guessing at what they're getting. I need to know that they know what they're getting too. So again, when I go to the final canvas, there's no question, and ooh, should I do this? No, it's done. So all I have to worry about is creating a painting. And then it goes from there. And then the logistics of when to ship it, and printing, and framing, and getting paid, and all that fun stuff. It just happens naturally.
You have a contract that you
still have? Yeah. And usually that happens right up front, too. What are your prices? There they are. Rich.
I don't know how comfortable you feel about this, but can you talk a little bit about pricing?
Sure.
And the timeline of from beginning to end on a commission?
Mm-hmm. Well, every it depends on what medium I'm working on, of course. A charcoal I can knock out in a day. That's not an issue. Pastel, you know, give me a week. And of course it depends on how many I've got in a row. Oils, obviously they're going to take longer. There's drying time, and usually in oil, there's something significant happening. For me, this is my experience, my anecdotal experience. It's an unveiling that's going to happen. There are, for me, occasionally family portraits that are done in oil. For me, most of my family type, kids' portraits, things like that, are pastel. Just mine. In terms of money being the price, My charcoal start at $750, just the head shots, and they go up from there. Pastel start at $1,250, and oil start at $2,500, and go all the way.
With your sports art, is there a big market for that, or did you have trouble?
I haven't been doing it for quite a long time. There was more. I think it's all photography now and playing with computerized kind of stuff. But back in the day, there was a big market for sports art. I loved it. I still do. I'm a sports nut, so I'll still do it just for fun.
I just
want to
say the way you do your wrinkles on people are done so beautifully. Like, I like how it's not too dark, but it's not too light. You see the age. History with people, and I just want to know for your pastel demo you had, you had the picture, the wrinkles. So you just let the pastel layer it, and then the wrinkles from the drawing just pop out.
Like I said, I work middle tone out.
Yeah.
So I never really lose anything, but I'm certainly gonna cover things. I go back and find them. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if I have a major wrinkle here. And I'm covering both sides of that wrinkle. That wrinkle is being softened a little bit. I'll go back and pop it. It's okay. I need to keep it. For me, if you see a pastel, one of my pastels in person, they're very, there's a lot of color. There's a lot of stuff happening. I like a lot of, I mean, you can actually feel it. When you take a piece of the paper, the actual weight of the paper is kind of, there's a lot of pastel on here. And that just, you get used to how somebody asked the question before, how do you know how much, and that just comes with the touch, time, and doing it. Every piece is different. I mean, I can work real limited. The question is how many colors on my palette. It can be very limited. It can be three or four. And it can be done. For me, the values do all the heavy lifting. They do all the work. And the colors get all the glory, right? Values have to be there first. So that's what I try to concentrate on. And every piece is different. I approach every piece like part of the pun, blank canvas.
What was the question there?
All of your portraits have a lot of character. Do you try to learn about your subjects?
Yes, I really do. I try to learn about my subjects. That's what I mean. At some point, it's not about likeness. Likeness has to be there. That's a given. Now it's about finding out what this person is about. If you can, you know, that's what's so hard about doing posthumous portraits. You try and get as much information from the family. What was this person like? And you can try and read it and give me as many photos as you can if you're doing a posthumous portrait. It's not just the one that they can give you. By the way, I used to do those, and the head would be that big. When I was just out of art school, I would do anything. Try myself crazy. Because you're trying to create something out of nothing, and then you beat yourself up because it doesn't look wonderful. Don't be afraid to say no, or just, I need more information.
Before you were established as a portrait artist, weren't you a mortician?
I was.
Can you speak of that?
Sure. When I went out of high school, I went to college. My first year of college, I was going to be a medical illustrator. That was my mindset. Of course, the best laid plans, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I was taking a lot of art classes and a lot of pre-med type classes. A buddy of mine was also taking a lot of the pre-med type stuff, and his father was a funeral director, still a good friend of mine. And so we hung out a lot. He needed the prerequisites with the pre-med stuff. I was 19 years old. I'll go to mortuary. So I did, here in Chicago. And I am a licensed funeral director in Baltimore. I specialized in restorative art. Go figure. People who die from emaciating diseases or traumatic accidents, where the family wanted to be able to see them, to view them, they would call me in to do that. Because basically, it's like a three-dimensional piece of art, if you can separate the fact that it's a human person. I enjoyed it. I was good at it. But I needed to be here. I needed to go to art school. You're leaving a really lucrative job, one where it's not going away, ever. With a really good firm. I mean, I was making good money as a 22-year-old. I said, well, I'd saved up all this money, I'm going to art school. The rest is history. I'm doing what I was meant to do, yes.
When you do your oil paints, there's different layers to the painting process. What types of mediums do you use?
I use 5-to-1 stand oil to turn. I try not to use too much in terms of medium, because I think it can get muddy and sticky and all sorts of stuff. But that to me, it gives me nice flow, and there's also a nice drying time.
And that's it?
That's it, yeah. And then, of course, varnishing, waiting 6 months to a year. You know, I certainly hit it with retouch along the way, but as far as a final varnish, waiting at least 6 months, usually a year.
What would you take away from being a mortician into like an artistic standpoint? Did you learn a lot more form?
Yeah, I consider that part of my journey, a God-given journey. That was absolutely a gift. What I learned anatomically, from an anatomical standpoint, and not just theory and not just looking at it in books, hands-on. Michelangelo used to pay grave robbers to dig up bodies so he could see what was under the skin. Other artists used to do that too. I got paid for it. And especially with the sports art, but now, and knowing what is happening under there, and knowing how muscles attach, tendons, bone, how that it plays a part in people who work realistically with the human form, and how important that is. It's really, really important. And obviously not everybody's going to have an opportunity to do that. So educate yourself with the human body in terms of anatomical studies. It's really important.
Like some faces better suited for charcoal and others.
Well, sometimes it's, you mean when I'm just doing it for myself?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, usually the face will tell me what to do. Kind of sounds strange to say, but it's true. It'll be like, oh, that's going to be an oil, or that's going to be a pastel, or that's going to be a charcoal. Sometimes, you know, if I have a photo reference, I've been known to do all three with using that first. You know.
How much time do you spend with subjects?
As much time as possible. And depending on, I mean, to get a half an hour with the United States Congressman was a big deal, you know, but I took it. You gotta get as much time as you can. But I would love to go have lunch with someone. That happens. Sit down, have lunch with them, or they'll have you come to their house and you know, treat you. And it's not like Sergeant's Day when you go hang out with the families for months at a time. You know, kind of creepy. But as much time as you can, and it doesn't take long. I like to think I'm a pretty good judge of character and getting to know someone pretty quick. But I really think that's important to find out what's going on inside that person and not just what you've been told or what somebody's told you. What artists influenced me? I'm schizophrenic in this regard. Sergeant Rockwell. I'm somewhere smushed in the whatever city I'm in, whatever museum I'm in, the first thing I look for is a sergeant. And of course, there's so many artists that I love their work. But if there's a Rockwell show ever anywhere, or I hear that a painting is on loan, I'm going to go see it as well.
What did you major in here in Miami?
Illustration and fine art. Painting. Oil and pastel. Yes, sir.
Whenever you ask people, can you take their photo for a painting, how many of them decline when they don't want you to?
I don't think I've ever had them declined, because I'm real careful. I don't just walk up to anybody. I've never. I had one guy who, he wasn't right. He started telling me about all sorts of things and how he was going to make me the next greatest thing in art. And I'm thinking, oh, poor man. But he's like the only one I can remember where there was an issue where he wanted me to sign a contract about, you know, and I'm like, it's not that big a deal. I just saw a wonderful face and, you know, I won't paint you, sir. This was after I took the photos. I have the photos. I can see.
So, this is after you approached him randomly, like didn't know who you were, and he just offered you this?
No, he's one of these guys that walked by my studio one night. I was literally getting out of my car, and this guy was walking by, and I'm like, oh, great face. And how you doing? Hey, would you mind? And I'm walking in. I got all my stuff. I use the line, your face is a portrait waiting to happen. Well, thank you. People are like that. Come on in. Oh, you do the whole thing, and then he starts talking. How many hours a day do I paint? As many as I possibly. When I was fresh out of school, I would paint 12 hours a day, easy. It's what I did. It's hard to say per day. If you average it out a week, 78 hours a day. It's not work. I love it. I love what I do. I want to keep getting better.
Are there any specific faces that ever like stick with you, like after you're done painting them, you kind of like think back to those, like after a while, or do you just like paint them and then you just move on to the next?
No, they're always in there. Every one of my paintings becomes, and every artist can say this, it becomes a part of who you are. You know, you can pour your heart and soul into something. And so, when I'm working on one, one will pop into my head, similarities. But no, these are like my babies. You know, they'll be with me forever. And sometimes, you know, I'll be looking through some old stuff. I mean, even putting this together, this is my very first PowerPoint, by the way. I'm old school, I did actual slides. And so, you know, just pulling up all these things to put in here, it brings you back. You know, every painting I can remember. I think that's the way it should be. Otherwise, you're just a machine just going through the process. And this becomes a part of your approach.
You know, when you left school, you're an illustrator. When did you make the decision or the leap from illustration to say, I'm going to start just doing portrait work and I want to...
They were kind of dovetailed at the beginning. I was doing illustration work, but I was still doing portrait work. That's what we were talking about before. And I think it was a natural thing that happened because the illustrations went dry on me.
Okay.
You know, the work, it just wasn't there. And so I just really pushed the portrait work more. And so it just kind of happened as a result of my circumstances. So it wasn't really a decision, a cognitive decision. I'm going to give up illustration. It sort of happened organically.
So, besides being the president one day, is there any other career goals that you have for, you know, the dreams that you want to accomplish?
Yeah. The dreams I want to accomplish. For me, yes, that would be the pinnacles to paint. Being president, any president. If I got to that point, I knew that everything underneath that meant I was doing something right. And quite honestly, I feel like I'm there without having painted the present. So I'm living my dream. It's not always easy. This economy has effect on people like us because expendable income isn't there. And people don't need portraits. Eat, right, or put clothes on. So there's some real difficult times. I'm not talking about financial. I'm talking about being able to do what I'm doing. And it's hard work. But boy, is it worth it.
I think this is a great time for you to be here as a portraitist, and we have the gallery now filled
with
work, and you being a graduate of the American Academy in 1990, two questions. One, do you see a development over the course of time in the art of portraiture based upon what you see here relative to what was, say, in 1990? And secondly, how do you find this work?
I think it's wonderful, by the way. I looked at all these pieces before. I'd say if you dropped me here in 1990 and had me look at this work and you put me here today, it's the same. And it's because the quality that's here. This place is a quality place. It teaches you right. There's incredible stuff. But there was incredible stuff when I was here, too. So that's what I'm saying. I was telling Aaron when I walked through here before, I mean, it brings me right back. Walking into Don's room over there, man, it smells like, oh, I mean, you know, I have my oils and all that stuff, but there's something about the concentration of all those smells. Just like, Ted Smiskevich was my painting teacher, and I can see Ted, you know, with that coat, I saw his coat. Somebody had an AA, American Academy of Art coat on. It's that coat on. Which is great because that's one of the great things about Facebook, is I can keep in touch with people like my former art teachers. And He's doing, still doing incredible work. But it's quality. Quality's quality. And 24 years later, it's still quality. That's what's so wonderful. You're in a good place, y'all. Yes?
Do you do anything else on the side besides commission work, or is, or are your commissions financially enough to cover everything?
You mean from a financial standpoint?
Yes.
The commissions do it for me. I do, as I showed, I do some still lives, and I'll do a landscape every once in a while, just to keep my sanity, and just because I want to. If I see something, or if I'm at a museum and I'm like, ooh, nice still life, I want to do one of those. No, just like we all get inspired. We see something and we want to do that. So, but the commissions do it.
Are there any groups that you feel are very important to your sanity and your artistic health to be part of?
Any groups? I used to get really involved in all the portrait societies early on, and I think it was good for me. I really do. To know that you're not the only one out there doing this kind of stuff. And you get in shows and things like that. I don't anymore. I really don't. I have other interests in my life. I'm a marathoner. That takes up a lot of time. I have a personal life. That takes up a lot of time. I'm a church-going man. I spend a lot of time with my church family. So all those things make me who I am. But I belong to all those. The Pastel Society of America still am. The American Society of Portrait Artists, and all the every major city has its own portrait society for the most part. But I think it's good to get involved early on, absolutely, and to get some information. And just to keep you in the loop as to seeing what's happened with your contemporaries. But nowadays, like I say, with communication the way it is, it's so easy to do that. It's at your fingertips. Back then, I would wait for this, you know, this beautiful glossy thing, this catalog to show up and with other people's work, and that's when I learned about all these people. Yes?
Do you feel like you're still learning?
Yes. The second you think you've learned it all, you are done. You're backsliding. There's no two ways about it. You're either growing or you're backsliding. Period. Pride before the fall is very heavy in me. I know if I stop growing, if that fire in me goes away, I'm fine. I've done what I've done, and I'm not going to get any. Which for some, that's fine. I will never live on my walls. No way. I think it's incumbent on me. And everybody in here has the gift of being an artist. I think it's an incredible blessing to have been given this gift. Now it's up to me to make the most of it. And that's what I try to do. Yes?
Have you ever encountered with somebody that's done a commission? You know, everything's been approved, you hit the final piece, you do the unveiling and the reveal, and then they're like, oh, I love it, but I hate everything about it. And then, well, what do you do about that other than, you know, do you redo everything?
It's never happened.
That's never happened to you?
No, and I don't mean to say that in a snotty way, but because of what I described earlier.
Uh-huh.
I'm with them the whole process
along
the way. So then there's no guesswork. They know exactly what they're getting, other than seeing the actual final product. And every time, they loved it. Because, as I say, all that stuff, the stuff that needed to be changed was at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't like this or that. Change this. Change the angle. Fine. This is where we do that. Not there on the final canvas. No, that's all that stuff was done ahead of time.
Do you occasionally work on stuff?
Outside of portraiture?
Yes.
Yes, I do. Yeah, as I say, I do still lives, I do landscapes, I'll do anything. I'm an artist. I'm always drawing or creating something. Yeah, absolutely.
Do you keep a sketchbook?
Not a sketchbook. I have sketchbooks everywhere. Scraps of paper. I wish I were that organized.
Do you keep a sketchbook?
I'll never forget Rich when I was here. He had a little watercolor sketchbook.
Still got it.
He went to Wrigley Field. He used beer as the. That's awesome. There he is at a ball game. Sketching. He's an artist. That's what you do.
Do you do walk-ins on your studio, and do you sell like your still lifes or some of your studies?
Yeah, my studio's in Rockford, and I was explaining this to Aaron. Twice a year, they have what's called art scene, where if you want, your studio can be open to it. You pay a nominal fee, and then they publicize it. So for the weekend, you just open your door. And for me, it's a wonderful way to clean the studio. it forces me to do so. But it brings people in. It's that kind of thing where people just walk in, you have the wine and the cheese and all that. So yeah, my work is for sale, the work that I offer. So some of it, because when you come into my studio, it's kind of like this, you know, it's my passion. I brought some shots of it. I have cards. Anybody who wants one of my business cards, you can go to my website and see all those pictures. And if you want, by the way, Facebook rocks. If you want to Facebook fund me, bring it. And so you can, and it's Vincent S. Chiaramonte, because there's a Vincent, there's a Vince Chiaramonte somewhere in the world that's not me. So Vincent S., but you'll see my face. Anyway, so it's kind of like this, and some of it is when a client comes in, I want to be able to come over here and say, okay, this is how we do this, here's the charcoal portrait, here's an oil study, and then here's the finished piece. So I have pieces in my studio of friends of mine, non-commissioned pieces. Things that I had to do to keep on the walls, because when I do a commission, it goes out the door. And so I have samples of every kind of portrait, obviously, in addition to my own things. But there are certainly still lives that are for sale, and studies that I've done that are for sale, sure.
When did you decide to go from the fine art building to Rockford, back to Rockford? What was your decision?
That was 4 years ago. It involved a divorce, quite honestly, Rich.
Okay.
There was a lot that went into that.
Sorry.
That's okay. I'm an open book. It's a great thing, because I had my studio there for years. I lived in D.C., and I lived here, and worked out of the Fine Arts Building. All that happened, and my studio was available again. That studio that you saw me paint in. And I couldn't have been more happy. It was like putting on a glove. Everything's fine. Very happy.
Anybody else?
Anybody else? Well, I can't hear you at all. How do I balance? My life? I go to work every day like anybody would go to work. I learned very on that a work ethic was absolutely essential in this career. You can't just assume that because you have this ability as an artist that the world's going to bow at your feet. You're going to get accolades. People are going to say wonderful things about your stuff. But the people that I know who have succeeded and are succeeding as artists work hard. And for me, I need it to be part of, not just part of my day, this is my day. I go to work. Whether I have a commission to work on or not, I'm going to work. I'm doing something, moving my career forward every day. And so I grew up in that kind of household. My father was very disciplined. I might work early and come home late. So for me, that's just, it's me going to work. And it fits into every other product. I know as a runner, I have to be disciplined with my running. Every day I have to run. It's just like anything else. You reap what you sow. You put into it, you're going to get out what you put in. Period. And I think a lot of people are disillusioned by a lot of accolades. and they assume that just because their work is at a certain level, that it's going to carry them through life, and it's not. It requires a lot of effort. But it's, again, bottom line, you end up doing what you love to do. So is it really work? Small place to be.
Anybody else?
Thank you so much.